the Lord in prayer. And Father, we thank you now for the word that is about to go forward. We give you permission to do whatever it is you want to do in this place. Pew by pew, row by row, saturate this place with your love. Saturate this place with your understanding. God, you be glorified. Devil in hell, you be horrified. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Somebody shout hallelujah. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse number 7. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse number 7. The Bible records these words. Here it is. The Bible says, but when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the men of Ashdod heard that the repairs of Jerusalem's walls had gone ahead and the gaps were being closed, they were very angry. Verse number 8, the Bible says they all plotted together to come and fight against it. Here is your shout. Verse number 9, the Bible says, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat. With your prayers, I want to talk about just for a few moments, I am under construction. If you don't mind, help me preach, find you a neighbor, look at your neighbor and shout, neighbor, I'm under construction. Pastor Hawkins, in the Bible days, if you did not have a wall around your city, you also did not have a way of protecting yourself from the enemy. If there was ever anything we need in 2017, people of God, we need a way of protecting ourselves from the advancement of Satan's army. In our text this morning, the Old Testament Globetrotter himself, Nehemiah, is in the process of rebuilding the walls of his beloved Jerusalem. And just like Nehemiah is having to rebuild, many of us, if you are honest, in here this morning, we are having to rebuild in our own life. Rebuilding from bad decisions and rebuilding from bad relationships and rebuilding from bad careers and rebuilding from bad investments. And the Lord has sent me to tell somebody, despite what it looks like, you are under construction. Don't take my word for it. Look at chapter 1, Pastor Corey, in chapter 1. Here it is. Nehemiah, he was a man that was taking the orders. But I kept reading my Bible, y'all, and when I got to chapter 4, he was now a man that's giving the orders. I just want to tell somebody, seasons change, y'all. You're going to get it in a minute. In chapter 1, he was serving man, but I kept reading my Bible, y'all, and when I got to chapter 4, Nehemiah is now serving the Lord. I just wanted to tell you, seasons change, y'all. In chapter 1, Nehemiah was praying that God will do, but I kept reading my Bible, y'all, and when I got to chapter 4, he was looking at what God has done. You're going to get this in a minute. In chapter 1, he was asking, how many sugars do you want in your tea, master? But I kept reading my Bible, y'all, and when I got to chapter 4, the tables have turned. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I've come to Millerton to tell somebody, despite what it looks like, you are under construction. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I stopped in to tell somebody, God said, even when it seems like you are in an insignificant place, I am still preparing you for significant things. You're going to get this in a minute. And I know it does not make sense why God would use somebody like Nehemiah, the cupbearer to the king, and promote him to be the project manager for the city. But I've discovered in my life that sometimes God will do unusual things with unqualified people to produce unimaginable results. You're going to get it in a minute. I said God will do unusual things with unqualified people to produce unimaginable results. And I need you to know that before we go any further in this service. Because see, ain't no need of you looking around at other folk wondering how they got what they got, how they live, where they live, and how they drive what they drive. Because I've discovered that God will do unusual things with unqualified people to produce unimaginable results. And I construction. I've discovered that people don't really have a problem with you until they feel like you are blessed enough. See, they don't mind you having one car, but let them find out you got two cars and working on a third garage. They don't mind you having one house, but let them find out you got a house in Germantown and a condo in Miami when family vacation was every other year. Ain't nobody have nothing to say, but now that you want to take your family out two and three times a year, people looking at you like you're crazy. When you was working for somebody else, ain't nobody have nothing to say. But now that you want to start your own business, Negroes looking at you like you're crazy. All I'm saying is people don't have a problem with you until they feel like you are blessed enough. And so that you're not in that group of people looking upside everybody's head. Let me help you out. Remember, God will do unusual things with unqualified people to produce unimaginable results. Unfortunately, some of y'all still not convinced. See, your mind, Corey, will have you thinking something contrary to how God operates. I'm too old for this. If this was going to happen for me, it would have happened in my 20s. It would have happened in my 30s. It would have happened in my 40s. It would have happened in my 50s. Our church will never be able to do that. Our church will never be able to have it like them. And that's why you can't watch everything and you can't listen to everybody. Because if they got access to your ear, they got access to your heart. I'm about to preach, don't worry. I said if they got access to your ear, they got access to your heart. Let me give you the principle, then I'm going to preach.
Progress
and became angry. Don't miss it. The Bible I'm just saying for free, but people of God, you got to be careful about what you heard that they said that he saw that she did. Some of y'all will get that on the way home. The Bible says that they heard. You know, people that have pity parties, they say stuff like, don't nobody want to see me happy. I got a newsflash for you. They don't ever want to hear about you being happy either. You ever been trying to be positive and share the good news about what God was doing in somebody else's life, and then all of a sudden somebody negative? I mean, you were really trying to be positive. The Lord is really blessing Sister Johnson. The Lord is really blessing Sister Johnson's children. And all of a sudden a negative voice comes in and say, well, if it hadn't been me, I would have.
can't stop me. Low self-esteem can't stop me. Donald Trump can't stop me. Sickness can't stop me. Foreclosure can't stop me. Because it's not about me, but who behind me that you can't see.
Somebody shout, do it, Lord. Come on, somebody shout, do it, Lord. The text did not just say they were angry. The Bible said they were very angry. You missed it. It did not just say they were angry. The Bible said they were very angry. So I had to do my research. I knew I was coming to Upper Canaan. And you have to understand Pastor Hawkins. He is a homiletical genius, exegetical juggernaut. And I did not want to embarrass him by having me to speak in my pulpit.
Prayer will shake you. Prayer will rearrange.
with your faith. Here is the principle that I'm going to preach. Here it is. God's not going to do for you what you can do for yourself.
Amen.
You don't believe me?
We believe.
All right. Well, let me help you. Let me put it to you like this. God wants you to have good hygiene.
Yes, He does.
And we want you to come up in here this morning. Amen. But guess what? God is not going to brush your teeth for you. God is not going to do for you what you can do for yourself. Nehemiah prayed, but he posted a guard day and night. He got in position. In other words, he got ready. And people of God, the last thing you need to happen in your life is for God to open up the door and you not be ready. The Bible says Nehemiah prayed. He posted a guard and he waited and he waited and he waited and he waited and he waited. I'm trying to talk to some impatient person. And he waited and he waited. And somebody in here knows what it's like to be praying to God and have to wait on him to show up. Am I talking to anybody in here? Is there anybody that has ever needed God to show up and you sitting there waiting on God to show up? Because if I can be honest, that's when you find out the difference between a natural storm and a spiritual storm. Somebody said, what you're talking about? At least when I'm in a natural storm, I got a 7-day forecast. I know when the sun is going to shine. I know when the lightning is going to flash. When I'm in a natural storm, I know when to get my rain boots. I know when to grab my rain jacket. But oh, when you in the middle of a spiritual storm, you don't get no 7-day forecast. Come tornado or tsunami, you got to pray and get in position. Not only did he encounter ignorant people, and under construction, not only will there be an inquiry and a position, but lastly, there must be an instrumental praise. Everybody in here, if you got two hands, I just want you to lift them and stand all over this building. Both hands lifted. Really quickly, I'm about to read to you a particular text, and I want you to hear this. The Bible says, I want you to repeat after me, wherever, and I'll say it like you mean it, wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there, and God is going to fight for us. Keep your hands lifted, people of God, this next season of your life. It's not I need to tell somebody that on the tip of Your God, God bless you.